from Psalm 107, verses 1 through 3. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble, and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Psalm 107, 1 and 3.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with love. He formed the creatures with his word, and then brought
Thanks, Ray. We want to welcome everybody here this morning. I'm going to take a quick moment to read something. Pastor Shaw is obviously not here, but he wanted me to convey some things to all of you. So I'm going to read just a little message from Pastor, and then we'll greet each other with the hand of fellowship. So let me read this. It says, To my dear church family, thank you for your love and prayers for my family and for me at this difficult time. Thank you for your generous and tender kindness. I look forward to greeting you Tuesday evening from 6 to 8 at Dakin Chapel or at the celebration of Marilyn's life, which will be held here Wednesday afternoon at 3. God's timing is always right, even when it seems strange to us. I rejoice in knowing Marilyn is joyfully safe in the arms of Jesus. Isn't that precious? I am seeking to be still, knowing that God is sovereign over all things. In thanksgiving for God's tender mercies and grace, Dick Shaw. What a wonderful man that we get to sit under and be ministered to and taught by every single Sunday. Isn't that amazing? And when he's not here, his presence is so missed. Anyways, with that, we are a church family, and let's warmly greet each other as family now. Privilege to welcome those who are listening on the radio or the internet to our service here at Caldwell First Baptist. Our speaker today is Mike Howard, and he'll be speaking out of 2 Corinthians 1, 3 through 11. Again, we welcome you, and we're so grateful for you tuning in. Thanks. Well, all right. Let's all mosey back to our seats now, and we will get started with our service for this Sunday. So again, greetings to everyone who's here. We're so grateful that you could come. We're just going to go through a few of our normal things that we go through each Sunday. It's amazing how Pastor does this every Sunday and doesn't think twice, and I have about 16 pieces of paper that I'm looking through here trying to make sure I don't forget anything. So the first thing let's talk about is our missionaries of the week. Missionaries perform such an amazing service because that's how the work of the church body gets done, is through missionaries. And the interesting thing is that even though not all of us have been commissioned as missionaries, we're all missionaries to somebody, right? We all have a ministry that is ours, that God has called us to. But the missionaries of the week that we're going to honor today are, first of all, Freddie and Candy Harris. And they are with Praise International, and they do a fantastic job with Praise International, but it's not just that. Freddie and Candy have so many ministries that they're a part of, one of which we get to partake in, Tita and I as well, in their International Friends Ministry. I'm sure most of us are familiar with that, but if you're not familiar with that, there are international students here at C of I and really all over Idaho that are here for college, but the focus of this group is at C of I, and we partner together with them, and we provide homes and families for these international students when they're not on campus. Campus closes down for holidays and over the summer, and so they need a place to stay because a lot of times it's way too expensive to fly back home, especially when back home is halfway around the world. So families get together and provide families and homes for these students. And it's been a joy for us because we've actually, you know, we started this as we get to minister to other people, but now we get ministered too because God's given us another daughter through this whole thing. So it's really neat the way that that whole thing works. God is so good and his mercy never ceases. So this is a stamped and addressed envelope with so where you can write a letter to Freddie and Candy Harris, and Jonathan is going to, with his Superman shirt, is going to get that to the first hand that's up. There it is. And our other missionaries of the week are the Bearheims, Jerry and Angie. And there's a letter here that's included to kind of let all of us know, or let the people who write them the letter know, how the ministry is doing, where they're at, and then some additional praises and prayer requests that they have. So Jonathan will get this to the next person that raises their hand as well. And that was quick. You guys are on the ball today. The next thing, let's review. Let's all stand. One of the things that's really neat, I did a study 2 years ago on the difference between the Western Church and the Eastern Church, the way that that Jews, that Hebrews worship as opposed to the way we do, the way synagogue services work as opposed to the way we do. One of the things that's really neat that they do is whenever the Word of God is recited, everybody stands. And as it should be, yes? When the Word of God is recited, we should stand. We should stand and give honor and reverence to our God. So as we stand, we will read from 1 Thessalonians 5, 8 through 9, or 8 and 9. That's the way Pastor always says it, 8 and 9. And I always read through 9, so I'm always reading it wrong. Anyways, 1 Thessalonians 5, 8 through 9, and let's read that together. We'll begin with the reference, and then we'll read the verse, and then we'll end with the reference. So ready? Let's begin. 1 Thessalonians 5, 8 and 9. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet and hope of salvation. And God has designed us from, oops, has destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Thessalonians 5, 8 through 9. Well, I could have done that one better, right? 8 and 9. Thank you. Good job. Okay. So as the men are going to come forward to take the offering, I want to let you guys know that in the offering today, any undesignated cash is going to go to Love Inc. for gas vouchers. That's a really cool thing. And Pastor does a really good job, too, of making sure that that's not being taken advantage of by the people who come for gas vouchers. So a really cool thing, and you can rest assured that the money that you give for that is actually going to people who need it and not people who are trying to work the system, because Pastor does a really good job with that, as I said. So we will, as the men are passing out the plates, this is, again, offering is something for our regular attenders. You don't need to feel obligated if you're not a regular attender to give. If you want to, that's great. But this is for our regular church body, for the continued maintenance and upkeep of the building and everything else that we do, these ministries that we talked about. So let's pray together. Father God, we're so thankful for everything that you do for us, Father. We're thankful for this building that we can worship in. We're thankful for the body of Christ that's here. We're thankful for this day, God, because we know that this is the day that you have made, and then we want to rejoice and be glad in this day, Father. We know that on this day, the people who are gathered here, these people in this instance may never, ever be all together gathered in this way again. And so we need to look at this day as a special day that you've ordained and find out what it is that you have for us this day. Father, we lift up so many to you that are hurting, that are in pain. Father, the first family that comes to our mind, obviously, is the Shaws. We love them, and we just want to wrap our arms around them, and we ask that you wrap your arms around them, Father, the giver of all comfort and hope and peace, that you would just wrap them up in your arms, spread your wings around them and protect them and just love on them, and that we help us to love on them and to be the hands that love them through for you, Father. We pray for our missionaries, pray for Freddie and Candy and for the Bearheims and for everybody who does your work, Lord. Missionaries, not just of this church, but of the global church that do your work. We pray for our country. Father, I lift up our men and women in uniform, our soldiers that defend the freedom that this country stands for, Father. We pray for them. We lift them up to you. We pray for our leaders this morning, God, that those that know you would behave as though they do, and that those that don't know you, Father, Father, would come to know you and make decisions based on what it is that you know is right, and that through those decisions that that we would humble ourselves before you, and that we would cry out to you, and that you would heal our land, Father. Again, we love you, we give you praise, and we lift this service up to you in honor of you. May it glorify you and bless your heart. In Jesus' name, amen. And I will now go through the announcements for today. It's just a plethora of fun today. So the first thing we want to announce, well, actually, first of all, we just want to welcome anyone who is here that's a first-time guest, and we want to welcome you in a way that you'll remember, that you'll have a keepsake for. So back in the, what do we call that area back there? The registration booth back here, there is a mug that's waiting for you as a first-time guest. It's a cool little mug. I think it's still the one that has the Ten Commandments on it. I think that's the one that we continue to give away. Really neat thing, a good way to remember your time here, your first time here, and hopefully not your last time here, because we want to welcome anyone who's a first-time guest with open arms and let you know that you are a part of our church body. One of the things my mom used to say to my friends when I was growing up is she would say, the first time you're in my house, your guest, from then on your family. So we want to look at it the same way here. The first time you're in here, you're a guest, from then on your church family. So we want that mug to be a reminder of you, to you, for your first time here. I also want to announce that Marilyn's service is going to be Wednesday, July 15th, so that's this coming Wednesday, right here at Caldwell First Baptist at 3 p.m. So those of you that want to come, and I know that you all do, that's when the service is. This Wednesday, 3 p.m., July 15th, right here at the church. If you have any pictures of church events or activities that you would like to submit for new photo directory, please email them to, I'm going to mess this up, to Callie Hazelbaker. I did that right? Callie Hazelbaker. Her correct email address is in the bulletin. Also, so you guys probably know, junior high camp was just this last week. So now this week is junior boys, and the campers meet in the church parking lot today at 1:30 to ride the bus to Warm Lake Camp. It says final payment for church is due, or for church camp is due then. So if you've made payments and you still have money to give, the final payment is due as the kids are getting on the bus. And I think, Richard, are you handling that again for this camp as well? So Richard, raise your hand. Richard's the guy in charge of getting everybody ready for camp. Young married couples are meeting Sundays at 6:30, and you can see the bulletin for location and all other information about that. The summer Bible study on Wednesday nights is canceled this week and resumes next Wednesday evening. So did everybody catch that? Summer Bible study Wednesday nights canceled this week but resumes next week. So if you show up this week with a bunch of food and stuff, you're going to have a bunch of food for you to eat, and nobody else will be there. Looking for an affordable mini vacation that the whole family will enjoy? You know, the way you do a question is you just kind of go up at the very end. So what we're talking about is family camp, and it's slated for August 6th through 9th at Warm Lake. And says, please pick up a registration form at the camp desk in the lobby or register online at warmlakecamp.org. Warna, did you want to say anything about camp, or are you good? Warna always wants to say something about camp. See, I should have run down and given the mic to Warna, but this is true. Just a couple more announcements that were that came to me just a little bit ago. So the softball, there's a softball game this Monday at 6:30 at Valley Pentecostal. So come out and cheer on Caldwell First Baptist. Roger, I think you guys have three games left, right? This is one of three. Yeah. So if you haven't had a chance to come out and watch the team, come out and watch. Maybe come out and bring your cleats. Maybe Roger might need some help. We'll see. Maybe somebody doesn't show up. If you can swing a bat or throw a ball, I'm sure he wouldn't say no to you playing. It's co-ed, right, Raj? Yeah. So men and women both are welcome. Here's something that we need to make sure we announce as well, because it didn't get in the bulletin this last week. So we talked before about International Friends. So August 1st is the annual basket party, I guess you'd say, for the International Friends. They do this each year. So each year, new international students come that hadn't been here the year before. And so what a bunch of us do is get together and put baskets together for these kids to welcome them when they get here. So that party for putting the baskets together is going to be August 1st, and it's right here at the church, correct, Candy? Right here at Caldwell First Baptist. And it's, again, put on by International Friends, and it's for the international students at C of I. And if you have questions, you can either see Candy or you can see Stephanie Talley. So either one. And then we're going to have information in the bulletin next week. And then also Tita is going to be putting the whole set of information on the internet. So you'll be able to see that there as well on the website. Or if you guys are friends of the church on Facebook, you'll be able to get those updates there. So I think that does it for all of our announcements. And we are at the point now where we're going to listen to some music. It is now my privilege to welcome Mike Howard. Mike is going to speak for us today. He's going to open God's word for us out of 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I have to tell you a quick little story about Mike. When I was first getting to know Mike, I love it when people do unique things that I'm not accustomed to having people do. It kind of shakes me up a little bit, and I go, wow, that's really neat. So Tina and I were dealing with a difficult situation at work last year, and Mike came up to us in his loving way that he does, and, oh, what's going on, and how can I pray for you? And so we talked about it and told him the stuff that was happening, and without skipping a beat, you know, you'll hear people say, well, I'll be praying for you about that, or you might even hear people say, well, let's pray together about that. But without skipping a beat, Mike just puts his arm around me and says, well, Father, we just come before you because we know that you understand what's happening. I mean, it was such a privilege, because he literally walked me right into the throne room of God and began to pray for me, and it was such a cool privilege. I never told you how much that meant to me, but it was really neat. I love the way that you did that. So here's Mike.
Can we take all this off? Yeah, sure. Thank you. Well, whenever someone compliments me like that, and I just spent a weekend with some new folks up in Sun Valley, one of my closest brothers in Christ was celebrating his 60th birthday, and we met when I was his youth pastor and he was 15. So, but, you know, they said some compliments about me just like that, and I always say this, come live with me for 2 weeks. And you'll find out the real Mike. This is a hard task to preach today, and my goal is to be faithful to God and to His Word, but to pass along His passionate, tender, and unbelievably wonderful comfort, because we're all grieving. As a pastor, I've been around death more than most people. And I remember when my mom called me in 1987, my father was 66 years old, and all of a sudden, while they were watching Johnny Carson late one night, it was Friday night, the night after Thanksgiving, he had a massive heart attack and died on the living room floor. And I just burst into tears. I didn't just cry, I sobbed. Now, I haven't done that many times over the years, but when Freddie Harris called me the Sunday morning after Marilyn had moved to heaven, I sobbed. And I know that a lot of you have sobbed too. We're all grieving. There's a lot of suffering in this world, and it can be different levels, different from what someone might call a minor suffering to severe and extreme. But the loss of a loved one that you've been married to and connected to, and I don't know how many years Dick and Marilyn have been married, 35 or 40 probably, 46. Wow, that's just unbelievably severe suffering, hard. Sarah, the boys, Marilyn's family, Howard and his sister, the extended friends, and we're going to look at a passage that talks about receiving supernatural comfort from God and how one of the purposes of that comfort is that we would offer it to others. And when I went through the hardest thing in my life a couple of times, maybe one that was a top five and one that was number one, Dick was always there for me, in my corner, believing in me no matter what. And that's the result of him experiencing God's suffering too. So all of us, we have an opportunity as God leads to share the comfort that we have received from God with Dick and Sarah and family. So let's pray, and then we'll read let's read the word first. And I think they're going to put it up. Are you going to put that passage up? Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3. You guys know I always like to give away books, and I do have a couple, one called The Case for Christ, and one that I bet maybe Tim has read this book, but I would be interested to see. Has anyone read Charles Spurgeon's little book, The Joy in Praising? Has anyone read that? I'm not surprised. Oh, you have. Neat. This is a wonderful, meaty book. Anything from Charles Spurgeon, the old pastor of the London Bible Church, or London, was it London Baptist Church? Can't remember, Richard. I had dinner and celebrated with a man from London, and I thought of you, Richard and Jan. and then another book called The Case for Christ. So, I don't even know exactly what the key is to winning these yet, but I'll think of something. And at the end, remind me, Jeff, if you'll remind me to give them away. Raise your hand, do that. Thank you. Okay, let me put my glasses on. I'm going to mainly preach from verse 3 through 11, but I think I'll read 1 through 11. So 1 Corinthians, can you go up there to 1? Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God, which is at Corinth, with all the saints who are throughout Achaia. Probably talking about the seven churches of Revelation, all those churches in that area. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies. And one key there, when you read that word mercy, don't read it singularly. Read it as a plural, because it says the God of mercies. And the God of a little comfort, all comfort, who comforts us in some of our affliction, all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For just as the sufferings of Christ are ours in abundance, so also our comfort is abundant through Christ. So there's a relationship between suffering for Christ and receiving abundant comfort from God. But if we are afflicted, verse 6, it is for your comfort and salvation. Or if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which is effective in the patient enduring of the same suffering which we also suffered. And our hope for you is firmly grounded. And by the way, I know that ESV is a little bit different than my old New American Standard here. And our hope for you is firmly grounded, knowing that as you are sharers of our suffering, so also you are sharers of our comfort. For we do not want you to be unaware, brethren, of our affliction, which came to us in Asia, that we were burdened excessively beyond our strength, so that we despaired even of life. Ever felt that way? Indeed, verse 9, we had the sentence of death within ourselves in order that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead, who delivered us from so great a peril of death and will deliver us, he on whom we have set our hope, and he will yet deliver us. So he talks about that. That verse 10 talks about past deliverance, present deliverance, and future deliverance. Verse 11, you also joining in, helping us through your prayers. So what can we do? The greatest thing that we can do right now for the Shaws, that's it. Helping them through our prayers. That thanks may be given by many persons on our behalf for the favor bestowed upon us through the prayers of many. There's a wonderful tension in the scripture between the sovereignty of God and the prayers of his people. Well, let's go to verse 3. When you think about it, for Paul to bless God, even though he has suffered severely, is radical. It's odd. It's out there. Because really, what do we want to do when we suffer severely? We're more interested in cursed be God, not blessed be God, not to speak well of God. There is a plethora of books out there about why good people suffer. Even Christian books wrestle with that topic. And I'm indebted today to reading sermons on this passage by John MacArthur and John Piper. And John MacArthur, he has a kind of a bite to his preaching and teaching at times. And he said, in light of this plethora of books, even Christian books, about how can good people have bad things happen to them? How can they unexpectedly lose the love of their life? He said, and it assumes that if we're good, bad things shouldn't happen to us. And that's just not biblical. Bad things happen to good people. Bad things happen to Christians. Really, really bad things. I just got through reading two books, and I would have brought them to give them away because I keep buying them, but guess what? I keep giving them away. And one's called Killing Christians, and the other one's called Dreams and Visions. They're the story of Jesus visiting Muslims, mainly in the Mideast, but in other parts of the world. And I was so moved by these two books that I wrote a little note to the author and said, are Muslims in America being visited by Jesus? And he said, yes, we just have not written about it at this time. But Jesus will come to them in a dream, and he will say, I love you, Kim, as Kim is dreaming. And then they will have a conversation. It may be very short at first. His visit to someone who's a Muslim may not last very long in terms of the number of visits, but sometimes it'll last months. And not just in dreams, in visions too. One Muslim man in Afghanistan hated all the killing that Muslims were doing to Muslims and Christians. So he would go out into the forest and pray and ask God to stop it and to ask God to give us peace. And one day he went out there, and by the way, every one of these stories sees Jesus exactly the same. Bright, white, dressed in tremendous light. And so one time, this Afghanistan Muslim man was in the forest to pray, and Jesus meets him there. And they met continually for a long time. And during those conversations, Jesus asked them to follow him. And they keep this a secret, knowing that extreme suffering would very likely be their lot if they were to confess that they believe the real Jesus is meeting with them in dreams and visions. Sooner or later, it's found out. One of the horror stories in the book, Killing Christians, I believe it was an 18 or 19-year-old boy who was getting these dreams of Jesus visiting him. And one day he came home, and he went into his room, and there was a bloody cross on his bed. And he made some kind of a noise that his mom and younger brother, who was bigger than him, heard. And so they went, and they said, "What's the matter?" And he said, "Don't you see that cross on the bed?" They said, "No, we smell blood. Did you kill someone?" And by the way, this is the son of one of the most powerful pirates in the Persian Gulf, a warlord, a Muslim warlord, and training this son to be a pirate too. And he said, "No, there's a cross on there, a bloody cross." And his brother said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "Well, Jesus has been visiting me in my dreams." And his brother just immediately started to beat him up. Just beat him to a pulp and left the room. And his mother said, "Leave right now and never come back." And so he did. He understood. He knew that his brother would tell his father, and his father would have the other pirates that worked for him kill his son. So he retreated, and God brought Christian Muslims to comfort him, and he came to Christ, just as Paul talks about here. And he was in a village in a safe house. Christians meet in secret in the middle of the night, and they will walk one at a time at intermittent time periods so no one suspects anything. So one day he's there, and I don't remember his name. Someone yelled at him and said, "I have a present from your dad, from your father." And he thought, "Wow, what would my dad, is he wanting to reconcile, or is it a bomb?" And so he opens the door, and everyone's gone. No one's on the street. The deliverer of the package has left a box in the middle of the street. Once you read the book, I may be a little bit off on some of these details. So he goes out and he shakes it and he said, "Man, doesn't seem like a bomb." Comfort in suffering. He opens it up and it's his mother cut to pieces. Now later in that chapter, because each chapter is a different story, and I'm not a big Kindle fan, because my mind tends to wander sometimes when I'm just listening, and I like to see the printed page and make notes, and it keeps me focused. But I guarantee you these two books, Killing Christians and Dreams and Visions, are great books to listen to on Kindle, because they will keep your attention. So a while later, he meets a Muslim Christian that knows his family. And they're talking, and he says, "Well, do you know what happened with your mom?" He says to the son, and he said, "No, other than, you know, I got that box full of her body parts." He said, "Well, she too was having visions of Jesus. He was visiting her too. And so what implied to me was she came to Christ and her husband found out and had her killed. And so in these stories, these Muslim, from young people to old people, from poor Muslims to rich Muslims who lose everything. Some God takes home like he did Marilyn. Some boldly go and proclaim Christ and he protects them and they don't get martyred. But exciting stories. And you know what? They're not cursing God. They're blessing, as it says here in verse 3, God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies. I want to take that word mercy and comfort. They're so trite to us. And have you think of them as God's favor. You know, we define mercy as not getting what you deserve. Well, wonderful, that's true. We get forgiveness. We get justification because of Christ's death on the cross for us. And if you're here this morning and you've never had the joyous experience of meeting Jesus personally, open up your heart today. May today be the day of grace for you when you come to know the Savior who loves you and died for you on the cross and wants to forgive you of your sins. We get mercy from God. Tender compassion. A father or a mother with a little child that has a owie, they get mercy from mom or dad. They get tender compassion. And it is plural. It speaks of it, God having infinite supply. Now that mom or dad who has a little one and needs mercy will at times find themselves thinking, gosh, they do this all the time. I wish they'd stop. I'm at the end of my mercy rope. Have you ever felt like that as a parent? But God has an infinite supply. He never runs out because he's infinite. And it's always a loving and wise supply too, of favor, of loving kindness would be another way to think of mercy. And then comfort. Let me just take a moment. What do you think of when you think of comfort? I have four recliners at the ranch. And I love the comfort and cushiness of my recliners. And most of the time when people think of comfort, they think of an easy, cushy life, full of pleasure and the absence of suffering. So comfort can't be that. It's got to be something else. And by the way, his mercy and his comfort, they are supernatural. And so in the midst of calamity, God pours himself out into us. And that word comfort comes from the Greek word parakletos, which is used of the Holy Spirit in John's gospel to speak of him coming as a helper. God in Isaiah in a number of places, and if I can find where I wrote them, God in a number of places, Isaiah 51:12, I am he who comforts you. 52:9, 66:13, all in the book of Isaiah speak of God the Father being a comforter. Christ speaks of himself as being a comforter, and he sends the Holy Spirit to be a comforter, a parakletos, a helper. That word also has connotations of a giver of strength, an encourager in the midst of whatever your trial is, makes you bolder and braver and more confident in God. So all that's wrapped up in that word comfort. And I love the fact that the entire Trinity is included. The Father is the God, a God of comfort. Jesus is our comforter. And the Holy Spirit comes to live within us as our helper, comforter. Okay, affliction. He comforts us in all of our affliction. The word affliction means pressure. It comes from a Greek word with that at the root of it. And as I said earlier, we all have all kinds of pressures. Your suffering might be employment or unemployment. I have a friend who's an acquaintance who's a tremendous artist as a knife maker. And he signed a contract, a no-competition contract, when he went to work for a high-end knife maker in the valley. And I don't know if any of you are in knives, so I'm trying to be as general as I can here. But it turns out he's the best artist, the best knife maker for that company. And he realizes how much money the owner is making. And to add to this, that no competition contract means if he quits, he can't do it himself, his own business. And I don't know if it's a 1 year no competition or two. And to add to it even more is this boss is mean. He's mean. So that's a form of suffering. I married a gal many years ago that lives in Washington now. And I would think it's probably around 15 years ago. And she called me this weekend. She's here visiting her parents. Said, let's get together on Monday, Mike. I'm having marriage suffering. My heart always sinks when I hear that. But there could be someone today that's having marriage suffering. Relationships are not easy. Finances, another area of suffering. Sometimes we don't have enough money to pay all the bills. So, no matter what our affliction here, it says in verse 4, all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. My daughter, as many of you know, is 35 now. And when she was 33 in December of that year, she was diagnosed with stage 4 breast cancer. That was suffering for her and for the whole family, her husband, her children, her parents, her siblings. And she went through radical chemotherapy and radiation. And it was so wonderful to see God's mercies and His comfort just rain down upon her. Her husband was a jewel among jewels. And her church, her local church, rallied and set up a meal plan for 3 days a week for like 4 or 5 months. You know, that's going the extra mile. And people saw that it strengthened her faith, this cancer calamity. That's not always the case. We always have a choice in the midst of suffering. And you like me, have known people who have become bitter and resentful, angry, and walked away from God. My daughter saw God as sovereign and as a loving father. And when people would come to minister to her, they would tell me they would leave ministered to. So there's a partnership in both suffering and in comfort. I had lunch one time with one of you, a family, and we shared personal things, real things about our families, about our concerns we had for our children and grandchildren. And when we were done, one of the parties said, oh, we're sorry we burdened you with that. And I said, no, this is real Christianity. You know, we can walk up to Mandy today and say, hi, Mandy, how you doing? And she says, fine. And she asks you how you're doing. And she says, fine. That's nothing. That's just being cordial. It's good, but it's not deep and it's not real. I just finished a book that I gave away here probably a year and a half ago called The Secret Thoughts of an Unlikely Convert. This book is gold. How many? Raise your hand if you've read this. Gosh, there's only a few of you. This woman is full of wisdom, coming to Christ as a leading queer theory professor, lesbian with a partner and two homes and pets, and a tenured university professor at Syracuse University. She calls her conversion a train wreck. It was suffering. It was very hard. But I want to encourage you, when I was at the 60th anniversary party, I was promoting this book, and one of the gals, in fact, the Jack, the one we were celebrating his birthday, he's a medical doctor, and it shows you how comfort is catching. Everyone say that on three. Comfort is catching. Oh, let's do better than that. I didn't even say three yet. comfort is catching. One, two, three. When I went through the hardest time of my life, this friend of mine that celebrated his 60th birthday, he's a medical doctor, and at that time he owned a twin-engine Piper airplane. When he saw what I was going through in my hardest suffering, a time of deep sobbing, he called his pilot. He lived in southern Illinois, and he kept his plane in Chattanooga, Tennessee, and he said, "Gary, we're going to Idaho to comfort Mike." And there was a time when that same friend was in despair, and he actually owns a home in Sun Valley, that I drove there, and his sister came from Seattle just to comfort him. So comfort is catching. And as God gives it to you, you'll end up giving it to others, and they'll be touched. And so Jack invited 17, four family members, and then 13 other people to come from all over America, and one friend from London, England, to celebrate his 60th birthday. And as I think about it, they're all people who have been comforted by God, not all, but most of them, and have offered comfort to Jack, and he's offered comfort back to them. Well, his sister Sally, put yourself in her shoes, and some of you will really identify with this. She told me a story, as I told her about this book, of one of her best friends whose daughter's getting married to her lesbian mate. And she's struggling with, do I go to the wedding? And so when I told her about this book and what a tremendous book it is, she wrote down the title immediately. She wanted to get a copy. And by the way, if you like this book and read it, a new one comes out that's kind of a follow-up by this same author. It comes out this month. So, The Secret Thoughts of the Universe, Unlikely Convert by Rosaria Champagne Butterfield. I'm not giving that book away. I hardly ever read books twice. This is so meaty that I'm going to start it this week reading it a second time. And I just finished it. Whenever I read a book, and I would encourage you parents to do this, I write a note to my children in the front and share how God used that book in my life. I'm on page 12, and already both tears and laughter are flowing. Oh, how I wish I could be the kind of Christian like Ken and Flo Smith, who loved and listened greatly. One of the ways this gal came to Christ is a pastor in his 70s who moved into her neighborhood, and his wife. They had her over repeatedly for a two-year time period. They went to her house on Thursday nights sometimes when she had her homosexual get-togethers. And they loved her to Christ. They literally loved her to Christ. I just finished July 3rd, this book, with tears of joy. It's a picture of God's work in converting a lost soul and a picture of what real Christianity looks like daily, as well as what the church should look like. I cried, I laughed, I quoted. See my first Facebook profile if you're interested. You'll see a lot of quotes from Butterfield. This book made me want Jesus more and want to be holier, more like Him, and more without sin. I found myself fighting against the flesh and turning to Him more in prayer for others and circumstances and to do His will and not mine. We're running out of time here. Okay, Let's skip to verse 8. For we do not want you to be unaware, ignorant, brethren, of our affliction. Big time affliction. We were burdened excessively. Let me just read you a little input on burdened excessively and all those words in this verse and the next verse. Crushed beyond strength to the point Paul despaired of life. That's what that phrase burdened excessively means. Unbearably crushed to the point of depression. And he says, beyond our strength, no possibility of a human solution or any human survival or resources. We despaired of even of life. Lost the battle. And I think what Paul's saying there, he lost the will to live. And by the way, he doesn't tell what the circumstances were. And if you have a morbid bent, you might say, well, I wish I really knew. And I've never wanted to know. I trust Paul's telling the truth, whatever they were. I lost the will to live. That disparity even of life is a long word, and there's a word in the middle of it that means passage. And what that phrase means, there's no exit, there's no hope, there's no passage. No escape. We get to those places where we can't fix it. We can't fix the trial, the trouble, the calamity. And why? Verse 9. Indeed, we had the sentence of death within ourselves in order that we should not trust in ourselves. Gosh, that verse would kill the psychological, psychiatric counseling business. Because it teaches just the opposite. You should count on yourself. You should be extremely independent and self-sufficient and pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. And we will relieve you of pain and suffering. That's the goal of counseling in our world. Both, and I'm sad to say, both secular and much of Christian counseling. But Paul later says, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, that he experienced God's. And by the way, when you see those words mercy and comfort, think of power too. Remember, it's supernatural. He experienced that in his weakness. And in that passage, he calls it a thorn in the flesh. And he found that he could experience God's strength best in his weakness. I don't know about you, but I am extremely self-sufficient and independent. It's something I've battled with all of my Christian life. And I have to keep relearning these lessons. So what does God do? Well, Mike, you made a C minus on that last calamity. I'll bring another one and see if you learn to depend on me more. And really, I often feel like I make a C minus. 2015's not over. Are there more calamities? Yes. Small ones? More than likely. Severe ones? Maybe. It's to teach us to trust in God. That's always the bottom line. Do we believe that God loves us and is for us and not against us, and we can count on Him no matter what? He says all afflictions. That means no matter what kind of trouble, what kind of storm. God, Paul was saying, God has been there for me. So the purpose is always ultimately the glory of God. But He gets glorified when you and I trust Him. And once I saw in a book by a Christian counselor that I like named Larry Crabb, this pyramid. And there was this one of not trusting God, and then on the next page was a pyramid of trusting God, and it had levels. But the bottom level for the not trusting God was, I've been hurt in life, and I can only trust me. Therefore, I will not trust God. And I believe that's true of every human being. That's our fallen nature. That's a part of our battle. And We want to do it ourselves. We want to fix us and other people, fix whatever the calamity is. And God says, no, I don't want you to fix it. You can't do it. Isn't that true? We just can't do it. But He can. And He will in His own way. So, blessed be God. We had the sentence of death within ourselves in order. And by the way, that word sentence of death is a phrase, it's a legal term, like in a courtroom. You've been tried and you've been sentenced to die. So whatever this trial was, it was just the biggest thing in the world that you could imagine to the Apostle Paul. And oh, by the way, you wouldn't get as much out of this if you didn't think like this. They are saying, the false teachers who are trying to undermine his apostolic authority and get the Corinthian church to turn to them, you know why we know he's not an apostle? God's punishing him. You know how we know he's punishing him? That's what all that suffering is. It's God. It's because of the Apostle Paul's sin. And I can't tell you how many times as a pastor people have come to me when they're really hurting and they're saying, what did I do wrong? Why is God doing this? That isn't a biblical way to think primarily. Do we suffer for our own sin? Are there consequences? Yes. But much of the calamity and the storms in our life are outside of that. And I love the picture of the Apostle Peter. Did he sin? Yes. Three times he denied the Lord. I can't remember who it was that was preaching on that recently, but he actually curses when he tells that lady he doesn't know Jesus. It's like he says, blank, no, I don't know him. You fill in the blank. And when the rooster crowed, he remembered what Jesus told him. And he went out and wept. Did he still get comforted by the Lord? Yes. Do you love me? Do you think Jesus knew the answer to that? Have you ever read that passage? Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Of course Jesus knew that Peter loved him. That was his way of affirming him, comforting him, and strengthening him. And he became radically different because if you look early in Acts chapter 4, and they flog them and tell them no longer to preach the name of Christ. And at the end of that chapter, he and all the apostles go out with their arms around them and their tattered shirts and blood dripping down their backs, and they rejoice in the privilege of what? Suffering for Christ. Were they being comforted? Yes, they were. And Peter knew maybe more than any of the other ones what it meant to be comforted by the Lord. So no matter what you're going through, turn to Jesus. Don't let Satan come along and make you bitter or hard or unforgiving. God is in charge. And would I pick the things that have been the hardest for me? No. Would I have missed them? No. I never forget my friend Brian. His brother ran over his 3-year-old child, backed over him, didn't see him, and killed him. And God used it to bring Brian back to Christ. He had grown up in a Christian home. And he would say to this day, I would have never chosen to lose my son. But I would have never missed that because of what God did in and through me. So there's great purpose in suffering and in the comfort that you receive. I'd like to close by having you think about, do you know of anyone other than the Shaws who are suffering right now? Someone that's a friend of yours, acquaintance, a fellow employee. Maybe they, and this is a form of suffering too, maybe they lost their favorite pet. You know, well, ask God to use you to pass on the comfort He's given you to them. That's your challenge today. That's your application. Let's pray. Thank you for your word. we wouldn't see things like this, Lord, apart from you giving us your inspired and inerrant word. It sheds a light on something that much of the world is confused about. You give a promise, an amazing promise, that you will comfort us in affliction. You will use affliction to make us people who persevere, who don't give up, who don't throw in the towel. You provide each other to pass along that comfort. And then you tell us the purpose, Lord, to make us dependent on you. Forgive us for our independency and self-sufficiency, for being lone rangers who seldom are real in our relationships. I pray that we would be a comforting church, that there would be a depth to our sharing in our relationships, that those on the outside would look in and say, hey, there's something special about those people. And we do pray for Pastor Dick and family, for your comfort, your infinite mercies, your infinite and supernatural kindness and favor to flood their hearts. Use your moving Maryland to accomplish your will in each of their hearts. You know where each family member is with you. May this be a time where each and every family member says yes, yes, yes to you, Jesus. In your name we pray. And they all said, amen.
I can see why Mike needed me to move my stuff. He needed a lot of room too. So I want to say one thing. It's amazing that Mike suffers with that independent spirit. I think a lot of us, as he said, a lot of us do. I myself do as well, and I'm sure a lot of us do. That attitude of I can do it, I can do this, and I'm not, almost sometimes even that attitude of I'm not a man if I don't do it. You know what I'm saying? If I don't do this myself. And so this next song, I think, is really fitting for what Mike, one of the things that Mike was just talking about. This is You Are My All in All. And I think until we get to that point where we recognize Jesus as our all in all, we're going to struggle with that that independent spirit that we have.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, though to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all.
Jesus.
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all.
My Jesus.
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Worthy is your name.
Lift your voices.
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Worthy is your name.
Love, O Lord,
your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, and your justice flows like the ocean's tide. And I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. Shadow of your wings,
your love, O Lord,
your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens.
Your faithfulness,
your faithfulness stretches to the sky.
Your righteousness,
your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your justice flows like the ocean's tide.
I will lift my voice.
I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. I will find my strength in the shadow of your wings.
I will lift my voice.
I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. I will find my strength in the shadow of your wings. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky.
Am I the only one that, I don't know, maybe I'm strange or weird, but at the very name of Jesus, it elicits an emotional response with me. Just saying his name, the privilege of praying in Jesus' name. And it's not like something that's this rote thing. I think a lot of times we get into this rut where, okay, now I have to end my prayer with in Jesus' name. I don't think that's the point. The point is that Jesus is the conduit by which we have access to the Father. It's only through him. But I love the opportunity to say his name. And there's so many cool different ways to say his name. I love saying his name in Hebrew. I love to say Yeshua, my Savior Yeshua. Just the name of Jesus. This song is your name.
as morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that arise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Jesus, in your name we pray, come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save like your name. Is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name.
Yeah, amen is right, right? Nothing has the power to save. So this last song, again, really neat. A lot of times all the time really, we look for God's blessing. We want to be blessed in this, we want to be blessed in that. I think what we neglect sometimes, what we forget sometimes, is that we need to bless God. We need to bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. This song can act as a way for us to bless the Lord through song, through music, through worship in music. Music is a gift, and we can give back to God through music. So this song is Bless the Lord, 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. before. Oh, my soul, worship your holy name. Worship your holy name. We will worship your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship your holy name. Worship your holy name. We will worship your holy name.
Time to give away a couple of books. What is the name of the author of the book I'm not giving you called The Secret Thoughts of an Unlikely... But okay. You Butter, oh, Butterfield. He said Butterworth. Who said Butterfield? Charles Spurgeon. If you are intentionally seeking to win a non-believer to Christ, and by intentionally I mean you are reaching out and spending time with that unbeliever, and as God leads, sharing Christ. If you are doing that with someone, they may be an agnostic, they may be an atheist, they may be someone who used to go here and doesn't walk with Christ anymore. If you're doing that, raise your hand. Okay, I'm gonna give this book, A Case for Christ, by Lee Strobel. It's a book he wanted to prove everything against Jesus and the Bible. And he became a Christian and wrote this book that is winning hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands, of people to Christ. Read it, and you may want to give it to your friend. Your grandson. Super. And that brings up, she mentioned her grandson. Something I need to tell you about this book. During that two-year time period where they were answering her questions and talking freely, and she knew they didn't believe in homosexuality, but there was no judgment. In fact, there is no judgment in this lady's heart. It's not in this book, but it's not because it's not in her heart toward homosexuals. It'll give you a different perspective, and it'll fill you with love. But during that time period, unbeknownst to her, something that was most significant was happening. And it's the same thing that Paul talked about in verse 11 of that passage we just studied. Your prayers helped, he says. That man's church, it was a Reformed Presbyterian church and a small one in her neighborhood. In fact, she used to stalk that church to see what weird right-winger homeschooling type people were going there. But they were praying for her. The whole church and the pastor and his wife, there was an invisible spiritual battle going on behind the scenes that she didn't know about. And that's going on for this grandson. And our children, there are so many of us, including myself, who have a child that isn't there yet with Jesus. Is that not true here? That's one of the things I've discovered in the 2 years I've been here. We need to pray together, not just individually, but we need to meet together and pray, because I'm convinced that's why she came to Christ. The prayers of those fellow Christians. Jude's benediction to his little one chapter letter. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, and one of the places we stumble is in suffering and affliction, and to make you stand in the presence of his glory, blameless with great joy, erasing all the bitterness from our hearts. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen. You are dismissed.